Welcome to the 2023 Solomon Trophy test match between Great Britain and the U.S. This was originally live streamed, but the audio didn't make it, so this is the recorded version that's been edited, additional footage added, and audio and commentary applied. The host club was the Sarasota County Croquet Club in Venice, Florida. Tournament director is the USCA president, Damon Bidencope. And leading the massive team that managed and ran this tournament is John Goldener, the president of the Sarasota County Croquet Club. Stuart Lawrence and Jeff Sue were tournament referees. And in addition to the USCA, we're pleased to have sponsorship from Chris Barley. And now from Don Oakley, whose croquet store by Oakley Woods can provide everything you need to get from beginner to world champion. This footage is from Sunday morning when there were six simultaneous singles matches going on. Debbie Lines, Secretary General of the WCF and captain of the team from Great Britain, is playing on court six against Ben Rothman. Off to the right, we have Zach Watson playing Gabriel Higgins, and to the left, you will see Matthew Essex playing Stephen Molyneux. The U.S. leads 10-5 in a 21-match test match, only needs 11 to win, so three courts are racing to see, in fact, all six courts are racing to see who's going to win the deciding match. Debbie started with blue on the east boundary. Ben laid a deep duffer tice, and Debbie just missed with black at partner. Ben Rothman, of course, has too many U.S. championships to count. He's won the British Open. He's been second in the AC Worlds, and he was the golf croquet world champion time before last. I'm not going to edit this one very strictly because it's basically a live stream, so it'll repeat that experience more or less. Thank you. you will have figured this out for yourself, but the graphic reflects clip position, not score. Over on court 7, Zach Watson is playing Gabriel Higgins, and Zach is actually on his peeling turn for his triple. Gabriel missed the lift shot. So he's pretty far ahead in the foot race to chalk up the win that decides the Solomon Cup. And there I go calling it the Solomon Cup. It's the Solomon Trophy. It is a big cup, but the event is labeled the Solomon Trophy. Over on court 5, Matthew Essick, I think, is in his first break against Stephen Mulliner in their first game. And back behind us, which you won't be able to see, Stephen Morgan, Kyle Maloof, and Tom Balding are all in their respective singles matches as well. This was pretty fun to watch. Matthews a couple of hoops behind Ben in his first break. Thank you.
guitar pattern. What you're looking at is the key that unlocks the guitar neck forever. It lets you hit all the right notes without thinking. It lets you flow up and down the fretboard.
Looks like Zach's peeling Pinault after two back. You can't see it, but he's got a good three back Pioneer. And the textbook diagonal spread from Ben Rothman. While Zach zeroes in on Rover. And Matthew completes his own diagonal spread. Thank you. I usually think of two back as the Bermuda Triangle of AC Croquet because of the lift and the balk line, but in this tournament it's been Rover. Let's see how Zach does here. A successful Irish peel. So Matthew and Ben both on peeling turns after the opponent missed the lift shot. And Zach pegs out to take game one. Ben made hoop one, but it looks like Matthew stuffed one, and Mulliner gets back in with red at hoop one. Still in game one. Thank you. Nice game. In this delayed triple attempt, that partner ball sometimes plays deeper as a hoop four pioneer because he still has to dig black out of corner four. Makes control around hoop four a little easier. On every lawn after every game, they're rechecking every hoop. Those guys are working hard. They are Atkins Quadway hoops. And I think on a speed test, the courts are running about 9 or 10 plumbers. They actually use a stimp meter here with a golf ball, and they were gonna do a correlation between the stimp meter and plumbers, but I didn't hear about the result. Looks like Gabriel misses turn three in game two on court seven. Putting blue in a skate position for the four back peel after five or before six. Yes, he made that hoop. I should have followed his placement of black as a pioneer and one back here because it's in perfect position for multiple different possibilities. All centered around when he happens to be able to get the four bag peel. Positioning red for the rush back to four back and an attempt at the peel after hoop six. But he will not let the urge to peel jeopardize the break. Oops, yellow didn't go through far enough to get a rush back to four back on red, so they'll focus on the break now. If he gets the four back peel now, then the double after three back is certainly doable. And he actually doesn't need a rush on black. He's got a great pioneer and blue at three back. And if he bounces off, then he could still do a straight triple if he wanted to. Now the triple's probably off the table now. Way too risky. Wow, either he's still thinking about the straight triple or he's just double loading four back because red is so deep. Now, if he rushes red into position and peels it now, it's called a posthumous peel, because it would basically mean that his peeling turn is dead after that. And he has black as an escape ball, so he could keep the break going, but there's really no point in doing that. It's probably easier to set a good lead with red for four back than it is for Pinnell anyway. Zach's diagonal after his first break in game two over there. So Zach just needs a triple for all the marbles. The body language says it all. I'm not sure, but he may have been setting up a reverse diagonal. So Debbie's in, but she's got a lot of work to do. Thank you. Matthew working on the delayed triple against Mulliner in game one for them. I think Zach just made five, sent red to one back, and now he's doing the first peel.
Throw a bunch of ice cubes in there, that'd be great.
Rover Peel, I think after three back. Patty Chapman likes that yellow ball over between Rover and the peg for that maneuver, but this works well too. Matthew pegging out to take game one against Stephen Mulliner, 26-7, triple peel. This is Zach's on penultimate rover versus 1-1.
Looks like Zach's about to get it done.
Had a rush point and basically break away at the west boundary. Rush it to give yourself some space and then make a beat. And then play a big like half. Exactly. That's right. Especially at this point.
Yeah.
The American team has had multiple mishaps in this position this week. Let's see how Zach does this time. It took Ben a while to get happy with this wiring, but I think it was partly because he was distracted by what's about to happen on court 7. So, spoiler alert, Zach Watson's going to win 2-0 over Gabriel Higgins. And for only the third time in the 25 or 26 times this contest has been held, the USA is victorious. And I think by the biggest margin ever, probably. The last time was in 2008 and 2009. The celebration is well-deserved. They did play out all the rest of the matches, and of course the details are on croquetscores.com. Lady in the large rim white hat is Jackie Jones, who founded this facility. And there's Mike Albert talking to Debbie Lines. And I would be remiss not to mention how hard he worked on this event this week. So Ben has Debbie wired at hoop 5. We generally talk about the tea lady shot as the one you take when your opponent wires you at hoop 1 and then lays up in corner 3 for a sextuple. Keith Ayton, who was actually a witness in Christchurch in 1990 when the tea lady happened, says that Joe Hogan was setting a lead for Bob Jackson to run an octuple peel, and that the shot was from around hoop 3 to just south of hoop 5.
Okay, good.
So the shot that Debbie's going to have in a minute or so is closer to the actual tea lady than the one we ordinarily label that one.
Is that it? Match over, Zach? Is that your match? 11?
Bingo. Now, when the tea lady hit the shot twice, they didn't know what to do with it. Debbie knows what to do with it.
Thank you.
Mulliner in game two with a diagonal minus one in third turn. Set up so he can approach hoop one off partner. I know, I'm not supposed to do this, but this one's special. This is Sadie Evans. She's Matthew's girlfriend, serious girlfriend, so I'm told. We'll look forward to seeing more of her at his tournaments in the future. Lucky guy. This next shot notwithstanding. Missed the short shot in turn four, giving Stephen Mulliner an opportunity for a fifth turn triple, something he's probably done 300 times.
What? I think so. The stream went out, but I got it all, but then the stream quit, so I don't know when it stopped. But I got that celebration and everything else. Thank you.
Now he's got to go get his reading glasses. I don't know why he doesn't just carry them all the time.
Thank you.
working on the penult peel in his fifth turn triple. Thank you. I didn't see how he got here, but it's obviously a transit peel if he's for three back after the rover peel. We'll slow this one down so you'll be able to call it yourself.
Here's how I'll pick him up.
So, Stephen Mulliner is about to even the score with Matthew at one game apiece. In a doubles game on one of the other clips, Aston Wade actually lost the game because in his backswing in a situation like this, he hit his partner ball with his mallet. Ever since that occurrence, everybody has been marking these balls in this situation. It doesn't matter that you mark them. If you hit it, it's still a fault. But it makes it easier to put everything right after the fault is committed. The rule is very clear. Once you take your stance, if you hit any ball other than the striker ball with your mallet, it is a turn-ending fault. the shoulders on the carrots of the Atkins quadways tend to stick up a little bit, and they've had several instances this week where somebody had to call a timeout and get that adjusted by the referee.
I ran it
This is the opening of game three. I think black tried to set up a double from Bebock on red and yellow and miss, and that's why it's so close. And here, because the position is so critical, Matthew's asking for Jeff to watch where yellow goes out so he can play a cannon if it goes out behind black. He needs a rush on black to hoop one.
All right, Jeff, could you watch the peg, please?
So Ben Rothman takes game one. Game two with a finishing sextuple by Matthew will follow shortly. Give us a like, subscribe, hit that notification bell. There's a lot more to come from the Solomon Trophy. Thanks again to our sponsors, the USCA, Chris Barley, and Don Oakley's Croquet Store.